Agenda for today is I'll be repeating the neural networks, convolution neural network. Then I'll be covering the convolution neural network through a code, and then I'll be going to a recurrent neural network. I'll cover the theory of the recurrent neural network, and practical I'll cover tomorrow. And so this will be the agenda, and then you will be left with one topic, that is LSTM. So in case they allow me one more day, then I'll cover LSTM. Else I'll take LSTM on the Saturday class. Okay, so let me tell you what is convolution neural network. So convolution neural network is basically a deep learning algorithm. So when we say what is a deep learning algorithm is nothing but a technique with the help of which what we can do, we can develop. So let's example, we have the images. So earlier, say till the time when we were working on the machine learning, what we had the data, that is the independent variables and the dependent variables, and we are trying to identify the relationship between the independent and the dependent variables. But when it comes to the deep learning, here we don't have the independent variables as such. So we have the images. So the beauty is now the machine has the responsibility to extract the information from the images. So it might be. So earlier, whenever we are supplying the data, if the quality of the data is not good, then what normally happens? It gives you less accuracy. Okay, so that was the scenario that we have been encountering. Whenever we have less data with us, so we have been seeing that this is giving us, the algorithm is giving us less accuracy. But here, the problem that we are trying to solve here, like accuracy and all the things will be a concern, which will be a concern majorly with the system, because system our particular CNN algorithm has the capability, has the the tube neurons which extracts the features from the images. So if we are providing images, we can now in CNN, we can't say that the quality of data is not good. We can say that the quality of the data is good, but the images that we have given, that we have supplied, are not of good quality. This thing which we can say in case accuracy is not correct, because it's not up to date. Sorry. So here the scenario is, this CNN has the ability to fetch the data or the features or the input variable from the images only. So we have been discussing the things that we have discussed yesterday are all around how CNN takes the input image, how it keeps on. So let's example, we have input image. So we have been discussing yesterday, with every input data that we had, the matrix that has been created is 28 rows, 28 columns, and 3 depth, which means that 3 matrices have been created for 28 into 28, 28 rows, 28 columns, and 3 matrices. So 28 into 28 into 3 variables that are being stored for a single image. Now let's example, if you have huge number of images, say 60,000 images, the example which we will discuss today. So 60,000, it will come to lakhs of crores of input values, millions or billions of values that can go into. So which goes beyond the system capability to process. So how CNN deals with it? So instead of taking the entire image into consideration, with every step, CNN tries to reduce the size of the matrices which has been obtained through the image, and with the objective function that it will retain the quality of the data. So let me tell you in other words, so now there are two things. One is, we have a problem that we have lot of images with us. We have lots of images with us with a very huge size, so which is beyond the capability of any algorithm to process. So what CNN does here is, CNN takes a image as an input data, that is 28 by 28 by 3, the example which you have seen yesterday. And with every subsequent step, it will try to reduce the size of the matrix, keeping the information with a minimal loss in the information. So how it does is, so it first creates three filters. So three is the example which I have taken. Say any number, say 10, 15, 5, whatever filters. Small filters, that is small 3x3 matrix. As a first step, it creates multiple 3x3 matrices, which starts from the left of the input image and goes from left to right. That is known as stride. And with every traverse, what it does is it creates a dot product of the filter that has been taken and the input image, and creates a single value out of it. Say a 3x3 image, when it is being multiplied by a 3x3 matrices again, 3x3 filter, when it is being multiplied by a 3x3 filter again, it creates a single value, say 1, 2. So when it goes with the entire image, so it reduces the size of the matrices that is being obtained is through filter. The first step is filter that it goes on. So are you guys with me till first step?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now second step is, so when this output of the dot product is created, it is another matrix that has been created, and this is known as, and when this filters goes around the input image, this means the filter convolves around the input image. This is known as convolution that is happening. So that's why the name came as convolution neural network, because it convolves around the input image, and output that is being produced is again a small matrix. So let's example, if with three filters, so when these three filters will come, these will have the random values in it, so 0 0 0 0 0 1 or whatever it is. So but just give me a second guys. Hey guys, so as a first step, it convolves around the input image and produces a matrix. So this weights that we have are basically the random weights in these filters that we have. So okay, as a second step, once we have the output from these, we apply a function to it that is known as ReLU. ReLU is rectified linear units. So again, the target is to reduce the size of the image. So what it does is, the values that are in negative, these values will be zero, and the values that are in positive will remain as it is. So, say the value is -3, -2, -1, it will be zero, and the value that is more than zero, say 3, 4, 5, will remain as it is. So now you see, earlier we have reduced the size of the matrix. Now we have been reducing the values within the matrix so that the processing won't be too much high and the information will be retrieved, because it has been said that the values that are actually negative does not contribute to the final output, and the values that are positive contribute comparatively high. So it keeps the positives value in it. Okay, somebody said. So till now, is it clear, guys?
Sir, so basically CNN just compresses the data. Mm-hmm. That's the main function.
Yeah, it compresses the input images, considering the information that it is getting from the input images will be retained, or there will be minimum loss in the in the quality of the data that has been received from the input image.
Okay.
After ReLU, it has to further go down. So it applies pooling. In this pooling, it picks the maximum value. So in the pooling, what happens? It again creates a matrix. It again creates a matrix which takes say a 2x2 matrix is being created, or say again a filter type of a layer is created. What it does is it again traverses through the matrices that has been obtained from ReLU. So the example with that we have seen yesterday. So just give me a second, I'll show you.
It will filter the image again and again for some steps.
Yeah. So that's the thing which it is doing. Okay, these are 1, 2, 3 steps. Okay. This is ReLU, then pooling layer. The target is to shrink the matrix. We take a 2x2 window and it traverses it on the matrix that we have, and pick the maximum value and put it into a new matrix. So it is a 2x2 thing, kind of a thing that goes in this, the matrix that we have received from ReLU, and tries to put the maximum value out of these four values into a new matrix. Are you guys with me?
So what is this new matrix?
After when we applied ReLU, a new, so whatever the output that is being coming from a input matrix is being again and again stored to a new matrix. So let me show you. So originally we have the input matrix like this, 28x28x3, let's example, a big matrix. Okay. So when we have applied filters, small filters like this, say 2, 3 filter, whatever it is, we applied these filters. But these filters will traverse on this matrix from left to right, and the dot product. So this filter traverses from here to right and creates a dot product, a multiplication, and gives a value, say 2. Say again for the 3x3, it gives a value 3. Say 4. Say 5. So this is a new matrix that is being formed after this. So as a first step, a new matrix is being formed. Second, this also creates a new matrix as an output. This also creates a new matrix. So this is the first step. Second is ReLU. ReLU, when it is being applied to this, creates a new matrix in output. Pooling layer, when the pooling layer is applied, it again creates a new matrix out of it. So every time, whatever operations that are happening between these matrices are being used to form a new matrix only. The operation actually forms a new matrix only. Are you guys with me?
That new matrix is the output, right?
Output, yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, this new matrix will generate by our own, or it will be controlled like two or three steps and then we will leave it?
Yeah. So I'll explain the CNN today in the code. Then you will see how this new matrix will be created.
Okay. So let me just confirm what I've understood. In the first layer, the CNN will form of 2x2 layer matrix, new matrix.
So no. In a first step, it will form a filter. This filter will be a, say, 3x3 filter normally. Normally a filter of 3x3 matrix and say 3, 4, 5. So these are the nodes. As we have the nodes in the neural network, these are the nodes.
Neural networks. Okay.
Yeah. So actually, node is a combination of filter, a value in the the rectified linear unit, and the pooling layer. It's a node, but the main node is this, in which the weights keeps on changing as the CNN keeps on learning.
Okay. And will the node matrix row and number column and size remain same for every node? Like 2x2, 3x3?
Filter is...
Filter
is 3x3. Filter is 3x3, but user has the option to change it.
Achha, okay. And then in the second second step, ReLU will be applied, and every negative will be...
Sorry, your voice is breaking.
Okay. So I'm saying the second step, we'll be applying ReLU. Mm-hmm. And in ReLU, all the negative elements will be discarded.
Yeah.
And in the third step, the matrix that we have got from ReLU will be divided into 2x2 matrices.
No. In the third step, a pooling layer is formed. In the pooling layer, a new 2x2 kind of a slot is being used, in which the matrices that have been formed through pooling layer are like the maximum value of these will be picked and stored in a new matrix. Did you get
it? So in a pooling, we do dot product, or in the ReLU we do dot product.
In ReLU, we are not doing any dot product. In pooling as well, we are not doing any dot product. We are going for the dot product in the case of the first filter only. Then next step is ReLU, where we are not getting the dot product, where we are just seeing in the matrix that have been produced through filter, if any value is greater than zero, then the value itself, else it will be zero. That's it. There is no dot product operation happening.
Okay, Mala, only the maximum value will be taken. Otherwise, except that, all will be zero.
So let's example. Let me show you. So let's example. This is the matrix. So let's example. This is the matrix. Okay. I have a 2x2 matrix. Say this 2x2 matrix. This will go to first four cells. It picks the maximum value, say 3, and puts it here. Again, it will go to another 4 cells. It will pick the maximum value, it puts it here. So, in this entire cycle, when it traverses through the entire matrix, the maximum values of these matrix are being stored here in a new matrix, a 2x2 matrix. So here in the pooling layer, we take a 2x2 matrix. So our 2x2 matrix is formed. So let me show you. Okay. So let's example, the original matrix that we have in this is, say, say, I have this matrix. So I'm constructing a small one, but consider it to be a big one. So let's example, I have this matrix. Now, in this pooling layer, a 2x2 kind of a matrix, a blank matrix is being formed. So this blank matrix is nothing but, say, this one, this matrix. It will pick the maximum value out of these four cells and store it here. Say, put it as 3. Let's see. Again, it will come here. It takes the maximum value out of it and stores here, say 8. Again, in the entire thing, it will happen and it will say, pick, it will make another matrix, say this matrix. So this is a function of pooling layer. So this has just reduce the size of this big matrix to this small matrix.
Sir, why we take the maximum value?
We take a maximum value because maximums have the higher intensity. So let's example. So let's example the point where your nose, where your forehead is being converted into your eyebrows. So that borderline. So let's example your forehead has an intensity in the form of matrix is say 5, 5, 5.2, 5.3, 5.5. So your forehead won't be a thing like your forehead is black for a region and then suddenly it converts to white. No, it might be a scenario that happens from forehead to eyebrows. The forehead is white or say skin color and eyebrows suddenly turns to be black. So there is a point when the intensity changes and during the entire eyebrows, the intensity will be higher as compared to foreheads, but very much similar to the area within the eyebrows only. So wherever the intensity changes to maximum, this means it is an important feature to capture, to identify the image.
Sir, the like edge detection?
Yes, you're right.
Sir, I need LCNN. It is used regularization. So what is the use of regularization here?
So your voice is echoing a lot. Can you please come again?
Sir, I read in CNN, there is a regularization process is also there. So what is the regularization and what is the use of this in CNN process?
So this, all the things that we have been doing are the part of regularization only. What we are doing, we are basically scaling the entire images. So if I'll go here, show, say. So this regularization, okay, this regularization you're talking about, I think from the Keras only. So this is a dot product that is happening, you see. So, okay. Let's go through this article. This will make the things very much clear. So let's say example, this is an image we have. Okay, a bike as an image. Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir. So
this has been converted into a matrix. First step is clear. So now the thing is, this is filter. A 3x3 filter is being created, which is traversing from left to right and creating a new matrix out of it, a 3x3 matrix that is being created. So this hidden layer is just act as a neuron where the weights are randomly assigned. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So this 3x3 matrix is taking dot product with these neurons.
Yeah, no. This 3x3 matrix is basically a filter matrix, and what this is doing, this is creating a dot product with the input value. So this yes. Input, this is the input.
Yes, sir.
So this is convolution process, no, sir?
This is convolution process. As you see, the filter is moving pixel by pixel, multiplying and storing them output. The filter is used to detecting vertical edges in an image. So the purpose is to vertical edge of the image is being detected through these filters only. In order to detect the edges in your computer training set, the filter in your convolutional network has been trained so that filters have the correct values. So the target is, as it goes on, it will have the correct values automatically with time.
So what is this vertical edges they mean?
So like the edges, so the entire thing is, so as I mentioned to you, so the entire process is so that we will have the maximum value of the image, maximum information from the image in a smaller size, in a smaller complexity. So edges, anything, edges and the corners. So edges, anything where, say, there is a slant change in the image. So let me tell you edge. So see, yeah, it will not show. So sudden change of the image. So edges, so this is horizontal edge, vertical edge. So, okay, let me tell you. So here in this image, the edge will be the point. So this point where I will be hovering my mouse right now. This is the edge. This point. Here we have an edge. So here in finger, the point where the finger is starting, the curve, it is edge. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So now. Coming to it. This is a filter that is happening. So this will make you guys very much comfortable. So pooling. So max pooling, average pooling. These are the two type of pooling. I told you about the max pooling, where the maximum value is stored. Another is average pooling as well. So this depends on from problem to problem, which we will discuss. So here, so a 2x2 matrix is being created and it is picking the maximum value. So first, see the blue area, 6, 8, 9, 7. So it is picking the maximum value out of it. So what is the purpose of pooling? So see here. So it is used to reduce the size of our output from the previous layer. So here as well, the maximum value is being picked. So another is average pooling as well, which we will discuss.
Screen is not visible.
Screen is not visible.
Yes, sir. It is visible now, sir.
Okay. So this is the pooling happening. So it is traversing. You see, it is traversing and it's picking the maximum value out of it. This is a pooling that is happening. And this is from where this feature map is coming. This feature map is coming from this value. This is a feature map. This value is a feature map. So the ReLU has not been applied, but actually in a scenario, ReLU or activation function is also being applied. Okay, as a third step.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
On which basis it is taking that stride as you said?
So it is just traversing this image from left to right and taking a maximum value out of it from the feature map.
Okay, here it is taking two strides. No?
So it depends on the metric that is being formed. So it is taking four strides, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Sir, what if we have odd matrix, odd feature matrix?
Sorry, your voice is not audible.
How does pulling work?
Sorry. Hello? Sorry, your voice is breaking. Come again.
Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah, now it's better.
Sir, what if we have a feature map as odd matrix?
So, like in that scenario, there will be extra calculation. Like this will go by 2x2 only. So there will be there will be overlap of a particular, say, two cells in it.
Okay, sir.
So here comes a dense layer. So dense layers are nothing more than a layer of nodes of neurons. So once you are the end of the network, single vector, Okay, here it will transform each this matrices into a single layer kind of a thing, a single matrix. See, so this is the input matrix, this is a convolution layer, this is a dense layer, and this is output layer. So this is being converted into a single matrix. So this is not being shown here. So yeah, regularization. Imagine that you have a model that has learned to detect pictures of cats. The model that you have defined has lot of parameters. You will notice that loss of value is minimum. However, you deploy your model to detect a picture of a cat in different setting compared to your training set. And you will notice that your model will not be able to recognize a cat very well. This happens because of the information that has traveled, the model is not able to identify the image. This happens because our model performed extremely well on the training. We use overfitting to describe the models extremely well on the training, but fail to generalize set of images. So, okay. Okay, so this regularization is another concept altogether. This is not respect to the CNN only. This is respect to the each and every algorithm we work on. It is level L1 and L2 regularization, if anybody of you heard about it.
Sir, so what is the meaning of the regularization means when we can use after the dense layer or?
No. So this regularization is not a process with CNN. Regularization is a process with all machine learning algorithms. So I'll show you. This is L1 and L2 regularization.
Yes,
this technique is basically used to reduce the overfitting. So I'll say,
so L1 and L2 both are used for the overfitting, sir.
Both are used for the to reduce the overfitting only. So I have not covered that. So that is the regularization that we normally use. So you can say regularization.
If someone asks what is the regularization, then what?
So regularization is a technique to reduce the overfitting in the data.
No.
So I have not covered the regularization during this course. So this is L1 and L2 regularization. So regression model technique is a lasso regression model. L2 is a ridge regression. So I'll tell you. So this is the thing. So it imposes the penalty in case anything is predicted wrong. It imposes a penalty with the help of which the overfitting reduces. So, okay, I'll go. So this is the convolution neural network that we have seen. After pooling layer, this happens. Then we go and we combine this into single matrix called a dense layer. That's output layer. So, I'll show you. So just go I'll just start with the Jupiterels. We will not be able to cover the practical part today as well. So during the practical, I'll show you how to work on it. As a step, first step, but I've done imported Keras. I've imported Keras. Okay, I'll repeat these commands again so that you guys can work along with it. Okay, what I'll do, I'll open a new book, new Jupyter notebook. I'll say from Keras dot datasets import NIST. This is a data set that is already being stored. I'll show you what is this data set all about. I'll say extrain xtest comma ytrain ytest. So extrain ytrain. Test twice x test y test is equal to more data. Let's shift enter. So now I'll see. So what is x train? I'll say x train zeroth element. First I'll say x train and say type. It's a numpy array, so I'll say train zeroth element, the zeroth element of array. So shift enter. This is a matrix, say 28 by 28 by 3. So you see like how big the matrix is. So this is the matrix. I'll say now import matplotlib dot pyplot as plt. And I'll say plt dot imshow x train, I'll say zeroth value. This is the first image.
So can you please go up a little? That x train and x test.
This one?
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you so much.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
So getting an import error, unable to found WHIST.
Unable to find MNIST.
Cannot import name WHIST from Keras dataset.
So you need to install the Keras again. The Keras is not working. Just go on the Anaconda prompt and say Conda install Keras. In case it doesn't work, the method with that I have shown you, like downloading the Keras file. So what it is, a user has swiped his finger, let's example, on any of the cell phone, and it has been stored at this image. So let's example, if I'll say, so the data is like this, x train, y train, x test, y test. If I'll say y train zero, so it x train one, and I'll say y train one. It is zero. User has swiped his finger on the cell phone and it is says zero. And here it says zero. So this is a zero. So whenever a user swipe the finger like this, the CNN has to identify it and say it is zero. Is the thing. Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir.
I'll say X train. Say one dot shape. It says 28 by 28 matrix it is. But if I'll say X train, so I'll say X train dot, okay. So 60,000 data points we have, 60,000 images we have in X train. So I'll say X train is equal to X train dot reshape. So I told you when it is 28 by 28 by 28, 28 by 3, it is a RGB image. So when it is 28 by 28 by 2, it is a black and white image. If I say 28 by 28 by 1, it is a single color image. So I'll say make it a single color image, 28 by 28 by 1, so that it will be a less kind of a load to the data. So as X train, I'll say X test. So Y train and Y test is single value, if you guys have seen. X test dot reshape. How many values it has?
Thousand.
Sir, can you please explain this line, sir, what you're doing in this?
So this image is basically a RGB image, you see. So this is a colored image. So I'm just trying to reduce it to a grayscale image. I'll show you. Just give me a moment, I'll show you.
So image will be black and white image.
Right? Yeah. So now you see extreme. One. Okay. See here. No, it is not. Just give me a moment. So extend. I've been reshaping it. So the purpose is to create it as a grayscale image so that it, let me say it is three. So let me say it is three. We'll do that. 28 by 28 by 2. So basic purpose is to create it as a grayscale image so that it will by, I don't know why it is not being created to grayscale image. So it, the purpose is to convert it into a grayscale image. So I'll show you.
Sir, 60,000 is the length of that X-ray and 28, 28, 1 is the code for converting into grayscale.
No. 28 and 28 is the shape, current shape. The every image, if I'll say, just give me a second. X train dot, it's X train 1 dot shape. It says 28 into 28 into 1. It says, okay, this has been stored as a one as a dimension. So it says 28 rows, 28 columns, and it is a, so whenever the image, so if I'll open any of the image, say if I'll open any of the image, so the image which I've opened, say, so this is this boy image, whatever the boy's image. So this image is basically a RGB image. So how it is being stored is, it will not being stored as a single image. So there are three colors that are stored on the back end. One is red, green, and blue. And all the colors that are made are with combination of RGB only, red, blue, and green only. But this image, this particular image that we have been using here, say this is stored as 28 28 1. This means there is only a single matrix that has been made. But in case of scenario when it is actually a RGB image, like a full HD quality image, it is being stored in a form of 28 by 28 by 3.
Achha, so then 1 means it is representing the number of matrices.
Yeah, the number of, if this is 3, then this image will be more clearer of a high quality image, which is basically a RGB kind of image.
Okay, sir, got it. Thanks.
Okay, so this is a grayscale image, sir.
Yeah, this is, I guess, a grayscale image only that has been stored. But actually, the grayscale image looks like a black and white image. I don't know why it is looking as a blue kind of image. It might be a certain thing. But normally, the grayscale image looks like say, like this. This, like this. So this is an image. You see, this is an image, RGB image. Here, red color, green color, and blue color, which is being converted into a grayscale image. So this is the grayscale. But okay, let's go with it. If like this is not throwing that the same. Just give me a moment.
So when we combine three layers, we got colored image.
Yeah, we are trying to simplify it.
Okay.
Now I'll say from keras dot utils. Okay, now what I'm trying to do is, so let's see, example, I have this data. So the data is for I've seen the data for Y train 1. I've seen it for.
So
Yeah.
So for grayscale image, use cmap is equals to matplotlib.cm.binary. Parameter.
Okay. No. So I'm not adding that parameter to the IM show like matplotlib, because I actually want to see if the image has been converted, then it will show the converted image, else it will show the same image. So I've just been seeing if 28 by 28 by 1, if it is actually creating which kind of an image. So in the original matplotlib IM show. So if I'll say y train 1, so the value came as 0. So now what we will be doing, so as I mentioned you, like the dense layer, so what the function is, so like when we have been discussing about the dense layer, a single kind of a matrix is being created, a single kind of a matrix is being created from the values that are obtained from a pooling layer. So here, so when we work on it, we need to create a single kind of a matrix out of here. So this zero is not a matrix, but we will convert it into a matrix kind of a format. I'll show you how. I'll say from keras.utils import two categorical, shift enter. So now I'll show y train is equal to two categorical y train. For example, I'll do this. I'll say y train, let's say 1. So the value that was 0, so is being say 1 here on the 0th place. Rest of the places are 0. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 10 values are here, and this 1 is being converted into a like a matrix kind of a format. If I'll say y train 1 or say 3, it might have a value 1. So that's why 1 is appearing to the first place of the matrix. So this two categorical has converted this y train from the number to a matrix kind of a format. And why it is required? Can anybody tell me why it is required to convert it into a matrix from the original values that we had?
For scaling down.
So the basic purpose is, why we have converted it? Because as I mentioned you, the output that we will be forming with the help of dense layer now onward will be able to match this kind of a format correctly. So I'll show you in the preceding codes when we will be forming a dense kind of a layer. So it will convert the entire matrix into a single form so that it's easy to match this output with that. So I'll show you.
So
yeah.
Sir, I have a question. So when we increase the number of hidden layers, so what is the benefit of increasing it?
So with increasing the number of hidden, we can increase the number of hidden layers or the number of hidden nodes in the hidden layer, both the things. So when we, when any of the problem is not getting resolved with the help of a single hidden layer, we increase the number of hidden layers in the neural network. So, but on the second side, it will increase the complexity of the model. So there's another very good saying is that when you increase the number of hidden layers in the neural network, 99% of the times you are creating a overfitted model.
Okay, so like minimum, what should be the range, like count of hidden layers depending on the model, is it, sir?
No. So in case you are trying to solve a simple machine learning kind of a problem, a single hidden layer with two neurons will be ideal. So as you keep on increasing the hidden layers or the number of hidden nodes in the hidden layer, you are like, I don't know whether you are adding it to the accuracy or not, but you are adding to the complexity of the model, which will lead to overfitting.
Okay, sir.
So how can we differentiate it orbit or normal?
So your voice is breaking. Come again.
Hello. Now audio.
Yeah. Now it's better. Yeah.
Sir, how can we differentiate it is overfitted or it is normal?
So a model that works well on the training data or on the test data, but does not perform on the new data set is basically an overfitted model. It has worked well, but it is not working well when it comes to the original values.
If we have the old value, then it will predict the same. And if we have new value, then we also don't know the it will predict right or the predicted value is right or not.
So let's example, you have broken the data into three parts: train, test, and validation. So validation set or a train test set, you have not exposed it to the system. So normally this is a scenario that happens. So in X train and X test or X validation, you keep on iterating and checking the accuracy, and the model has started giving you the 90% accuracy. The third set, which you have stored only for checking for the final iteration, you see the accuracy is coming to 10%.
Okay. Sir, instead of accuracy, can we check precision?
Yeah, anything. So accuracy is just a name which I have been telling you. So anytime when I say accuracy, it means it might be a precision, recall, sensitivity, specificity, or any other metrics which you are measuring. So accuracy is just a term which I have been using.
Both are same or there is a difference in
between?
So is there any difference between accuracy or precision, or both are same in?
No. There's a huge difference between accuracy and precision. Precision is true positive rate. Accuracy is how the accuracy of the model is. So let's example. So I've already covered this topic, but let me tell you in one or two lines. So whenever, say, let's example, you're trying to measure whether your model is able to identify the patients who are having a cancer or not. So here, the whatever model has actually given an output. The true cancer patient versus false cancer patient, whatever the outcome is coming, it is the accuracy. The point of interest for the model is you will be able to identify the right cancer patients. So if the true cancer patients are being identified by the model correctly, then it is precision. If cancer patient and non-cancer patient it is identifying, then it is accuracy.
Okay, sir. So like we do in the confusion matrix.
Yeah. So everything is coming from confusion matrix only.
Okay, sir.
So now it is y-test is equal to two categorical y-test. I just mentioned in a similar way. So I've just converted it into a category. So now I'll say from Keras dot models import sequential. So what is the sequential? So this will allow you to create layers in the model. The layer is the different layer that we will add, say pooling layer, say dense layer, any other layers that we will add. So this will allow you to create a layer into the model. Now on the second line, I'll say from Keras dot layers.
Sir, why we import sequential?
So as we have seen, we have different layers in the CNN algorithm that we make. So different layers. So let me tell you. When we've seen the CNN, so it has first as input. Second is a layer I have. This is again a complete layer. In this layer, we have, say, feature, features that we have created. We have a ReLU. We have a pooling. So again, we have a this kind of a thing. Feature. ReLU. Sorry. Pooling. So these are the layers. These are the sequential layers that are with the help of which convolutional neural network is being made. The sequential is doing nothing, but it is allowing us to create the layers.
Okay, sir.
I'll say dense. Import dense. Dense is the output layer. For output layer, I'll say another is conv 2D. I'll tell you what is conv 2D. This is for two-dimensional images. I'll say flatten. So I'll tell you conv 2D deals with two-dimension matrix. So dense is for the final layer. I'll tell you flatten as well. So this flatten, when we say flatten, so this kernel size is the size of a, so basically the filter matrix. So when we have, okay, so when we basically go to this, so I'll tell you what is the function of this this flatten layer. So I'll tell you, just give me a moment. So once this operation will come, so now I'll create a model is equal to, so the flatten has a purpose that it binds. So I'll tell you what the flatten is. So okay, just bigger in size, I guess. Model equal to sequential. So I've just created a model. Model equal to sequential. Sequential is again now. So whenever we add, so we will add it in this sequential only. This is a network. This is a empty kind of a empty layers it has provided to us. I'll say model dot add. I'll say first layer I will add is sorry. So this sequential will automatically create a filter layer in it. I'll say conv 2D. I'll say the number of nodes in this first layer are say 64, 65, whatever nodes you want to take. I'll say, so this 64 in first layer. So this, what we're doing are the number of nodes. Okay, let me write it down. I'll show you about how, like why I've taken 64. I'll say kernel size is equal to 3. The three kind of the things that we have taken. So it is the size of a filter matrix that we have been created. So filter matrix. So we have taken a 3 filter matrix. This is nothing but this matrix 3. three matrices have been created with 64 nodes. Three by three filter matrix is created with 64 kind of a matrices, 64 nodes that have been created. So let me tell you. A 3x3 matrix is being created, and similar to this, 64 matrices have been created. Filter matrices. Okay. And I'll say in the first layer, activation is equal to ReLU. Okay, and what was the input shape we had? Input shape is equal to 28 multiplied by 28, 28, 1. The input matrix has a shape that is 28 by 28 by 1. So this is the first layer that we have created. I'll say shift enter. ReLU is the Next is, what I do is, next I add another layer. Okay, so I add here. I'll say model dot add. Again, cone2D. I'll say whatever you, again, if you want 62, I'll do a 62. So this is what? This first layer has been created. This first layer has been created. This first layer has been created. Now I'll go and create a second layer. Model.add cone2D 32. I create a 32 nodes here with kernel size equal to 3 and activation again is equal to ReLU. So we can specify, okay, after this I'll tell you how to specify any other activation function here. So I'll say model dot add, I'll say flatten. So what is the purpose of flatten? Is to bind. Model dot add flatten. So with flatten we actually bind the layers. So this is the first layer we had. This is the second layer we created to bind these two layers. We use flatten. So like this, we used flatten here. I'll say shift enter. Now I'll say model dot add. I will add a next layer, that is dense. Dense is used for output layer. So model dot add, I'll say dense. So how many nodes I will be adding in this dense? So our output actually has 10 nodes. With the help of two categorical, we have converted into a matrix with 10 nodes, if you remember. Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll tell you one more activation function. Activation is equal to softmax. I'll tell you what is softmax. So let me tell you. So this is soft mesh. This is used in the output layer of a neural network that predict the multinomial probability distribution. So in case we have a two kind of outputs, say 0, 1, we use sigmoid as a function. But in case the output that is ranging from 1 to 10 in our scenarios, a number can be 1 to 9, sorry, 0 to 9. So the number that the user has swiped ranges from 0 to 9. So it is a multinomial kind of a problem. So we use a softmax as a function. Sorry. Let it down as a is equal to softmax. Why we use softmax? Because
sir, your screen.
Oh, my screen went. Okay, just give me a second. Softmax is used when in the dependent variable we have nominal output. Nominally, say anything that cannot be like the binary 0, 1 true false, and it cannot be ordered. Any other output apart from that, we use a softmax. So in case of a binary, outcome, we use sigmoid activation. Okay. Alt shift, enter. Now, another important thing is, now the neural network has been, a convolutional neural network has been made. Shall say. So sequential, engine of sequential CNN has been made and stored at this location. Now, how do we measure it? So the thing is, we have an optimizer. So the gradient descent algorithm that we have mentioned, we will add it here. One of the method of gradient descent algorithm is ADAM. So what is ADAM? ADAM is one of the gradient descent algorithm only. It is advanced than gradient descent. So let me show you. So it's a optimization algorithm for stochastic gradient descent for training deep learning models. Stochastic gradient descent is nothing but gradient descent that works in batches for training deep learning. ADAM combines the properties of AdaGrad and RMS probe algorithms to provide optimization algorithm that can handle sparse gradients or noisy problems. So whenever we have the matrix like this, what is sparse matrix? Sparse matrix is basically a matrix in which there are many zeros. So in case we have any matrix where we have lots of zeros, then the gradient algorithm that works best is ADAM. So I'll write where it is gone. Okay, here. So here. So I'll say model dot compile. From here, the model will start running. I'll say optimizer is equal to ADAM. Let me write some notes. Start running. This ADAM is a variant of gradient descent algo which works well on sparse matrix. Okay, now So optimizer basically controls the learning rate. So this Adam is an optimizer only, and the so this basically decides how the learning rate, basically how fast the weights of the model needs to be calculated. So through this gradient descent only, and we have taken Adam here. So now we also need to specify here another metric, that is loss. Sorry, because we are working on to optimize the loss. The objective function of this Adam, this gradient this gradient descent algorithm is, so how this gradient descent algorithm will work? This will go from input to output, predict something, say output is 4 and it predicts 3. So now it will work on reducing this one, the difference, the loss function, the error. So this error we are taking as, so let me tell you, as categorical gross entropy. I'll tell you what is this.
So, sir, we can say that optimizer can be used for the reduce the losses.
Yeah, optimizer is always being used to reduce the loss or the errors.
So, it can be also said that whatever the gradient descent problem is that we mean, so you already tell the 4 is there and it optimizes the 3 value. So, it can use the gradient descent problem also by the
optimizer. Your voice is breaking.
So I want to say that its optimizer can reduce the gradient descent problem also.
No. Optimizer, gradient descent itself is an optimizer only. Gradient descent is a type of optimizer that works on reducing the loss function and optimizing the weights of the neural networks. So that's why we need to supply how it will measure the loss. So this is a loss function, categorical loss function that is used in a multi-class classification tasks. So this is using multi-class classifications. Right now we have different values in Y ranging from 0 to 9. That's why we are using a categorical gross entropy. In case it is a dual problem, then we have a binary gross entropy, something kind of a thing. I'll also search for it. So that is the thing that we have. So I'll say, is a loss function that is used in multi-class classification tasks. So the problem that we have is we have a multi-class classification ranging from 0 to 9. And what we are trying to measure is accuracy. I'll say shift enter. So now I'll say, so in this kind of a sequential model, we'll say model dot fit. What we're trying to fit is X train and Y train on validation data is equal to X test versus Y test. And I need to specify the epochs, the number of runs it will cover. I'll say is equal to 4. Let's see example. So epochs is 4. So now it is running. You see, it is optimizing the loss. So is the first thing you see, the loss keeps on reducing from 2 to 1, 1 to 0s. See, it is running. So it is taking the number of repetitions. This is the first epoch that has been going. So as we increase the number of epochs, you'll see after a point of time, the loss will be optimal. So you see here only.
Sir, what do you mean by ETA? What is showing, sir?
Estimated time.
Okay. So is as in means it has any maximum value or it will increase based on the
so program? It has taken 4 minutes as the estimated time to complete first epoch.
Hello,
sir. More epoch means more accuracy, or it is
no. So after a point of time, as you increase the number of epochs, the accuracy will not further improve. So I'll show you this only. So let me show you this. In the first epoch, the loss has been reduced to a point. Then from the second epoch, it will further. You will see the how the value goes.
Okay, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
So can I ask you something? Like here, validation data we have taken X test and Y test. Mm-hmm. So instead of this, can we use that K fold validation
technique? Yeah. So but this will take like a lot of time. Yeah, and definitely we can use it.
So here
instead of X test, Y test, like we should use K fold in brackets in quotations. We have to write that, sir. Like how can we use those validation such things?
So for that you need to first import k-fold from sklearn, from sklearn.validation import k-fold, and then we will be doing something like k-fold between x test and y test. I don't know the exact format, but it can work.
Sir, so here why ETA will decreasing right now?
ETA started with 4 minutes estimated time to calculate it, because it will not run for a continuous time period of time. ETA has been taken as 4 minutes, and you see ETA keeps on reducing. So it is 55 56, now it will go, okay, I don't know why it is not reducing, so at least it should reduce. So now it is reducing 53 seconds 52 seconds. So estimated time, so within that time, whatever loss it will be able to cover, it will
come in zero.
It will come zero, and then the second epoch will start. So this is a stochastic gradient algorithm. Stochastic gradient is it run in batches. So it has taken a few batch of the images, and it will keep on iterating. So it will not iterate till the end of the day or the year or for a like a continuous period of time without any without any like stoppage. So it has to stop somewhere. That's why ET is there, estimated time. You sir, see how based, complex based the system on the, is.
Sir, based on the ETA value, we'll define the accuracy, right?
So based on the ETA, what will happen is, it will say in 4 minutes, the number of rounds, whatever number of rounds, it will be able to take from input to output, or whatever weights it can adjust, it will adjust till there only, because we have a constraint. We have a loss, we have a loss function. Then again, we have, apart from loss function, we have the accuracy that keeps on increasing, the loss that we need to reduce, and all these things that we need to do. So it has to take a time, certain time interval within which it will perform, else it will take a very long amount of time.
Hello, sir.
Okay,
sir. Sir, can you please tell me where is this pooling done in the previous codes? Like in which step the pooling is done?
So here the pooling is not being done.
So after then we'll do pooling, no, sir. Like
yeah. So okay. So we must specify any argument. So let me see like what is the argument of pooling here. So here the pooling has, so the example that we have been seeing. In that example, they have not used the ReLU as a thing for constructing the thing. So here I have not used the pooling, but I'll show you how to use the pooling.
And sir, we have created here two layers of network. So if we want to create more layers, so
yeah,
just we need to add the same thing, but we shouldn't specify input shape.
No, no, input is a thing that you need to specify in the first layer all the
time. First layer, yeah. In the remaining layers, there's no need to specify input shape.
Yeah, yeah.
So we can write a function for this, no, sir? Like basically yeah, we'll write a function.
Okay. We can. Okay, I guess I need to write only two epochs, as it will take next 15 minutes, I guess, like at least 5-10 minutes more.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, there is a Visual Studio error while installing the Keras.
So you need to just like whenever you get an error, just check it on stat exchange aside. It will tell you why that error is coming. So there might be a problem. So you might need to install some other package to run that. Just paste it, whatever error is coming, just paste it over the Google. The site stat exchange will open, and that will, there the people will help you identify why that error is coming and how to basically eliminate that error.
Okay, sir.
Stack exchange.
So why are we using softmax for dense?
Softmax is basically used whenever we have like the dependent variable has nominal output. Nominal is anything that goes from like that is not binary, that is not ordinal, but it is nominal that have a multiple values in it, say red, green, blue, yellow, and all the things.
Multiple categories.
So that's why I use softmax as a function. In case we have a like a output 0, 1, something like that, we use sigmoid as a like output.
So we don't use ReLU here, right? For the dense.
We use ReLU. In dense, we haven't, because dense is basically the output kind of a layer with the help of which, like whatever these layers has produced, these will be flattened formed into a 10 node matrix, so that we will be able to match it with the actual test data that we have.
Sir, in what cases we can select the activation function, which activation is useful for the this model?
So this is again a point of conflict, actually, which activation function to be used. So these algorithms are known as the black box algorithms, where we actually don't know how these algorithms are working on the backend, because you see how many epochs are going on, how many calculations are going on. So in case you won't be able to get the relevant accuracy here, so softmax is fine. Softmax is used because we have a multinomial problem. Category cross entropy is fine because we are working on the loss function, because output is multinomial, so we're using categorical loss cross entropy. Adam is still fine because it's a type of algorithm, a sort of optimizer. But ReLU, which activation function to be used in place of ReLU, is a point of conflict. Why? Because every time, in case the model is not giving accuracy, the hit and trial with another activation function is the option we have. So it's a hit and trial only that we need to work on, because we don't know with this problem, with this epochs going on, which activation function will be able to adjust the weights correctly, will be able to convert the inputs or to the output correctly.
Sir, I have a small doubt. Actually, yesterday you told us gradient descent is a problem occurring in the ANN. So it's same is occurring in the CNN also.
Gradient descent is not a problem. The problem is vanishing gradient is a problem. So which I have not explained to you. Gradient descent is basically an optimizer. How it works is the work of gradient descent is to optimize the weights. So yeah. So that's why the gradient descent is not a problem. It is just a methodology or optimizer which helps in optimizing the weights of the neural networks. It is not a problem. The problem is vanishing gradient or exploding gradients, which I planned to explain today, but in RNN it is more important. But some kind of problem come in like CNN as well. So normally what happens when we start, Okay, I'll explain during the RN only. What is vanishing gradient? I'll explain during the RN only. No, I guess the third epoch is running. So let me scroll it down. So it will take some time. So you see the lows in the first epoch is it was 0.2057. In the second epoch, it is 0.0608. Have you seen this? Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
Now the loss is further reducing. So this is the thing, like when you have a high configurable system, which with high RAM, high thing, so this epoch will be able to produce the higher accuracies, because this will be able to take more number of runs in less time and will be able to provide you more accuracy and kind of a thing. So this is the, so here why GPU is required. GPU is basically required when we are working on the very complex kind of a data with complex kind of a relationship as an input. So in let's example, in input we have say colored images, lots of data. So instead of 60,000, I have 6 lakh images, 60 lakh images, then it won't be processed by this system. We use GPU based enabled system with high RAM and high configuration.
Sir, in ANN, says input and gates is multiply, and then we have add to the bias also. So what is the use of this bias, sir?
So this bias is nothing but a constant. So the thing is, in a regression, what we normally do is, we say y is equal to mx plus c. This c is a constant. So here as well, we add, so every time, let's example, you measure a rope, every time you measure a rope and you find it, say 11 meter rope you measure and you find it as say 9.8 meter. Again, you measure 12 meter rope, you find it 10.8. So you see there is a bias of 1 centimeter all the time. So in which the system won't be able to calculate, or the neural network won't be able to calculate. So instead of that, it just adds 1 to it. That every time it is getting a bias of 1. So if 1 will be added to all the figures as output, then the output will be more nearer, because the 1 is a thing which it won't be able to identify. That is known as bias.
So one means constant, so nearer to 1 we want to achieve near to 1.
No. So let's example, every time you measure a length of a rope, okay. So you have four ropes. One is 10 meter, second is 9 meter, third is 8 meter, and fourth is 7 meter. The 10 meter rope which you are measuring, you are saying it is 9 meter. The 9 meter you are measuring, you are saying it is 8 meter. The 8 meter you are measuring, you are saying it is 7 meter. The 7 meter rope you are measuring, it is saying it is 6 meter. So every time you have a constant difference of 1, which nobody is able to identify ever, lot of recurrence, lot of epochs, and a number of things. So what you will do, you will just add 1 to whatever value that that it is throwing. So this is nothing but a bias. So I don't think I will be able to cover RNN today.
So what are those numbers that are increasing the 60,000?
These are basically the number of images. 60,000 is the number of images. Every time it will take 60,000 is a batch, as a total batch, shuffled batch, and it keeps on iterating the epoch so that the weights of the filter layer will be adjusted.
Hey sir, we didn't mention any batch size. Nothing.
Yeah, we can mention the batch size as well. It has taken entire 60,000 as a batch size. So there are n number of parameters we can mention. So batch size, pooling, n number of things we can mention here. Because in the real life, in the real life scenario, I have done a one project only using CNN. So these things are theoretical now, like very much, but not very much practical in this scenario as well, because when it comes to the original data, it, let's say, example, you are running a product in which a CNN is used on the backend. If it will take this much of time for calculation, nobody will use that product. So that is the basic constraint when we work on these kind of problems. If it's a one-time resolution, it is fine. But in case it is a thing that is running on backend, then it is a problem.
So in the meanwhile, let me.
So CNN basically used in healthcare industry, like for lung cancer detection or something, right? So
many things like lung cancer detection and like some kind of things like Google has been using, click the image of a picture and Google will identify which picture it is. So there also CNN is being used. So a number of things where CNN is being used. Let me show you. In the meanwhile, it works.
So here I run the code in my system, but here dash size is taken as 1875.
Which value?
Same code, sir, while fitting the model, sir. I use the same parameter what you have used, sir. But dash size is taken as, here is different, sir. Not 60,000, it is 1875.
So,
okay. How it is changed?
So have you specified batch size as a thing, which I would try to see here?
No, sir, I didn't specify anything.
Okay, so in this scenario, it has taken a batch size less. That's the thing which I've been trying to like say. So batch size is a parameter here. So I'll show you how to fix it so that this particular problem will not occur. So this is the way to add this pooling layer. Say after this, you add max dot add max pooling. This is the, somebody asked me how to add the pooling layer. So I'll just copy it and paste it and use it. Say here, extain model. When we say model dot fit, we specify batch size equal to batch size. So I'll show you. So here, I'll say model.add max 2D pooling size 2x2 is the way to add the pooling layer here. Somebody asked me. And the second is, epochs, I'll say, is running, so I won't add. So, but I can add it later on. 200. This will help me in adding the batch size. Right. You see the loss has been reduced to 0.0364 and accuracy has gone to 0.9844. So if I say epoch is equal to 1 and I'll run this. So you see batch size, I specified 200. I don't know why it is going 1600. It should stop at 200 only. That was a thing. It has been mentioned here. Batch size is equal to 200, it should be. So here the batch size has been specified as 2. Okay, so guys, so this is basically the convolution neural network. So it will again iterate one epoch. I'll check how to actually change the batch size to 200 or 500 thing. So guys, any doubt till now?
Sir, why you mentioned batch size?
Mm-hmm.
Is the mean of batch size? My question is why you mentioned here batch size?
So I mentioned batch size because every time it is taking 60,000 as a batch, entire 60,000 images as the images to train the weights. But I actually want it to take 200 as a size of the random 200 images to train the weights. That was a thing which I would try to optimize, but it was not doing so.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
If there is a scenario like we got here accuracy like 95%, 97%, but what if we get lower accuracy? So what are the things we should do? Like which parameters we should work on?
So there are three things you should work on. One is reduce the number of the layers that you have added. So let's example, we have added two layers. Say, let's example, we have added five layers and the accuracy is 99%, but it is not the actual scenario. Then we should reduce it to 3, 2, 1. So the number of layers we should reduce. And second is like the number of epochs that we have tried, we should reduce that while running for it. We should try a different activation function when we are running for it. These are the 3-4 things we should change so that it will give the right kind of accuracy.
Okay, sir, I think that batch size is every time it is running, it take 200 because the 48,000 it increases by 200 every time.
Okay, yeah. So I think you're right. So every time it is increasing by 200, earlier it was increasing by 1 by 1. Yeah, you're right. So this batch size is nothing but, okay. Let me tell you now, I got it.
No, sir, but here I mentioned again, batch size 200. It has taken the 200 batch.
It has taken, so it will take 200 images together and these 200 images will be thrown from input to output. Then again, it will take 200 images. Then again, it will take 200 as a group of 200 images that will process from input to output is a thing that is happening here. Yeah, thanks for noticing. So here you see, when I take a batch size of 200, so the accuracy is 99.62. And here, when the batch size is, so it is a accuracy of 95. So again, epoch which I have tested on this model only, that's why the accuracy is further increased from 98.84, it has 99.62. So this is similar to 5 epochs if I mentioned over the top. So if I'll say batch size of say 60,000. It will say it will not. Okay, so it is not, it will not allow me. I'll say $10,000. It will start now, or it will hang. So let it execute. So guys, in the meanwhile, do you have any questions?
Sir,
the kernel died because it has a lot of things to be processed. Yeah, please.
Sir, can you show me the code where you have written that reshape? Actually, it's throwing error for me.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, here we have taken the data from the Keras itself. But what if I have some images and I want to train on those images? So how would my data, how can I take my data in this Jupyter thing, sir? So should I keep all those pictures in a folder or?
Yeah. You should keep all these pictures in a folder and you should read it read it as a through a for loop. All these images being read and stored. So let me show you.
So instead of CSV, I should take IMG or JPG.
Yeah. So see how to read JPG.
Here.
So guys, your voice is breaking. Whosoever is speaking.
Sir, I think here we can use image data generator, sir.
So this. So yeah, please come again. Whosoever is speaking.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, now it's better. Please go on.
Sir, for random images, we can use image data generator, sir.
Image data generator. Okay, so I have used a for loop like that I mentioned here to read the images. So till the time images are not left, it will keep on adding the image to the images IMG only, and it will the variable that we have taken is the data, it will being stored there only. But somebody is saying like we can use image loader.
No, sir. Image data generator.
How it works?
It is API from Keras. Sir, I just heard about that image data generator. Actually, I don't know how it actually works.
Okay.
In image data generator, sir, actually, we define the proper scaling, input shape, RGB format or a gray format, like that. So.
Okay. So normally, I use this for loop only. Now we have mentioned image data generator, so I'll check that as well. But I normally work with this, like I create a folder, I keep on reading the files and keep on adding into the images. So images is a list which I have taken. So these images are keep on storing in the this as a list, and finally these images will become the image that we have in total, or the folder that we have taken. But I'll check the image data generator as well.
The images are like bit pieces of the big picture, right?
So images can be anything. So might be it's an image.
Multiple images.
Yeah, multiple images. Say the images from a marriage. You have collected it and you are being getting into the Python. So you can get that as well.
Actually, my question was like, if we give images, then how can we give the output like this image is cat, this image is dog?
So as a first step for an X-trained dataset, you have to read it in the form of images. For a Y-trained dataset, you have to read a CSV file, which basically says that first is cat, second is dog, and all this thing. Then you will be converting this into a form of a scalar matrix only, the thing that we have created right now.
Yes, sir, I got it.
Sir, how can we get that image data set?
So the event image data set that I have tried is from one of the event that is happening with one of the organization, where people come and they click the images of the person and they write their email and the name of that person. So the activity that we need to do is, in case any of the person is coming again to that event, then the system will be able to identify this person has already there and his email ID is this only. This was the data on which I actually worked on CNN and tried to create this kind of a problem. But
it is like the real-time data.
Yeah, real-time thing that I have done. So that's why when I trained on CNN, I applied one or two epochs only, because every time it works, it takes a lot of time because of normal system. Then we shifted it to the GPU and to the cloud computing only, so that it will take a less amount of time. But that project didn't work well. That project didn't work well because of the high processing time. So this was the only project I have actually done using CNN.
Sir, you'll continue RNN now, sir.
So if you want, I can start RNN. And in case you are fed up, I'll start tomorrow.
It's not like that, sir. Like if it takes time, then can you please show us that deployment thing, because we have done the whole CNN project now, sir. So it would be easy, I guess. Or else that any other time, like I'm just suggesting.
Deployment means like how to deploy a model.
Yeah, how to deploy. And if we give the new, how to give a new input after deployment.
Okay. Let me show you. Just give me a second. So let's say example. I'll show you how the deployment works, but I'll show you this entire deployment with the help of a live project only. So how it actually works, okay. I'll show you. So it's not difficult. So let's example. So let me stop this. This is out of the course.